Hello everybody, welcome to Word Shard. Today we are going to deal with a very interesting story, which is A Face in the Dark, written by Ruskin Bond. So the story is for the ICSE students who are in class 9 and class 10. They will have this story in their treasure trove book. And we will be dealing with the story. It is a very simple and easy and interesting, exciting story. And all of you, I think you will like it. Even if you are not an ICSE student, listen to the story because it is exciting even for a child who is 6 or 7 years old. It is interesting, easy, as well as a ghost story. See, A Face in the Dark is written by Ruskin Bond. As the story is written by Ruskin Bond, we first must know a little bit about the author. Ruskin Bond is one of the most popular Indian authors of British descent. Okay, he was born in Kasauli, which is in Himachal Pradesh, in 1934 and grew up in Jamnagar, Dehradun and Shimla. See, all these places are so interesting and beautiful, isn't it, with mountains and hills. He has written over 100 short stories, essays, novels and more than 30 books for children. He currently lives in Mussoorie. This is another beautiful place. So you might think, why am I showing this picture to you all? Why is this picture here? This picture is the Eton College. Okay, this has a relevance with the story. And how is this relevant to the story? Let us start reading the story and then we might see the picture again. See, Mr. Oliver was an Anglo-Indian teacher. Who is an Anglo-Indian person? Anglo-Indian is a person who has both Indian and British origin. Okay, maybe his mother is Indian and father is British, somewhat like that. So, Mr. Oliver, the main character, you can call him the protagonist, the main character of our chapter. He was a teacher, an Anglo-Indian teacher, and he was returning to his school late one night. So, he was returning to his school. And when was it? It was in the, maybe late that night, okay? On the outskirts of the hill station. What do you mean by outskirts? Outskirts means at the edge of the town, okay? At the, almost near the end of the town. There was a hill station of Shimla. So, even if you think the spelling of Shimla is wrong, it should be S-H-I-M-L-A. You write it S-I-M-L-A as it is written in your story, okay? So, late one night, Mr. Oliver was returning to his school. And where was his school? His school was in a hill station of Shimla. From before Kipling's time, the school had been run on English public school lines, and the boys means the students, it was a boys' school, and the boys, most of them, were from wealthy Indian families. So the school and the children was the children who came to study in the school were from wealthy families. Okay, it was all those rich families, they used to send their children to these school. Wore blazers. What is a blazer? Blazer means a coat or a jacket which has a, you know, the logo of the school, resembles the school. Caps and ties. So how were these students dressed? They used to wear blazers, caps and ties. Because, you know, it was a school where the rich students used to go. Life magazine, that is a name of a magazine, in a feature on India means when the Life magazine was writing about India, they had called it the Eton of the East. Now you can understand Eton College. Okay, this is the Eton College, and this school in Shimla was quite like the Eton College. Okay, it was the Eton of the East. As it was quite similar to the Eton College, the real Eton College, so it was called the Eton of the East. Okay, next. Mr. Oliver had been teaching in the school for several years. Now, our character, this Mr. Oliver, used to teach in the school for a huge number of years. Okay, the Shimla Bazaar with its cinemas and restaurants was about 3 miles from the school. See, the bazaar area was far away from the school. It was how many miles? It was 3 miles away from the school. And Mr. Oliver, he was a bachelor. That means he was a person who was not married. Maybe he was the only person, he was a lonely person who was living in the school campus, maybe in the hostel. usually strolled in the town in the evening, returning after dark. What do you mean by strolled? Strolled means he loved to walk. Okay, he used to walk into the town. See, the school was far away from the town. It was 3 miles away from the bazaar. So you can understand that it was a hill station. In the hills you find, you know, pine trees and all those huge trees. Okay, it is dark everywhere in the after evening. Okay, so you can understand that this can be the scene. So what did Mr. Oliver do? Oliver used to return through this dark forest in the middle of the night. Why? Because he used to go to the bazaar, which was far away from the school. After he has, enjoyed over there in the bazaar, in the restaurants, in the cinema halls and everything, he had to return to the school because that was the place where he lived. So when he returned, how did he return? He returned through this dark forest. You can understand in the middle, almost late at night, he used to return. Okay, now, returning after dark, that means when it was already dark, when it was past evening, when he would take a shortcut through the pine forest. So there was a road also, proper road was also there from Simla Bazaar, but it was a long road. Okay, if somebody had to avoid the forest road, then they had to take the normal path, but that normal path was a long way. Okay, maybe a lot of distance had to be walked. So Mr. Oliver was a brave person. He was not afraid of the woods. He was not afraid of this dark forest. So he used to return, take a shortcut through the forest and return through the forest in the darkness. Okay. Now, when there was a strong wind, the pine trees made sad, eerie sounds. What do you mean by eerie? Eerie means strange, unnatural, you know, very frightening kind of sound. What happens? This we all know, isn't it? Whenever we go to the mountains and the wind blows, strange sounds start. We start hearing strange sounds from these pine trees. You know, when the wind passes through the trees, the leaves are shaken and they make a strange kind of sound, which if you are lonely in the middle of the forest, in the mountains, you will be very afraid when you hear this sound. Okay, so this kind of sounds were heard that kept most people to the main road. So mostly people did not come through the wood, through the forest, because normally we are afraid, isn't it? In the middle of the woods, we are through the middle of the woods after evening when it is dark everywhere, you avoid the forest road, isn't it? So most people also used to take the main road only. They did not go into the forest in the night. Okay, and because of those strange sounds, you know, they were scared of it. But Mr. Oliver was not a nervous or imaginative person. Now, Mr. Oliver, this one can be a question, that why do you think Mr. Oliver took the forest road? First, because it was a shortcut. Second, because he was not afraid of the strange sounds. He was not a nervous man. He was not a coward. Okay, so he did not believe in ghosts maybe. So he used to take the forest road. He carried a torch. Now, to walk through this dark woods, through the forest road, you need a torch, because otherwise you might get lost inside the forest. You might you might not be able to know which way to go, isn't it? So he used to take a torch with him, and its gleam, then you see there is a dash. Now, this is one such day when Mr. Oliver was returning through the woods to his school. Now, that day, what happened? The batteries were running down. Now, what happens is the battery, the torch that he was carrying, the battery which he used in it started to, maybe it was not working well. Maybe the light was flickering. The torch light was flickering. Flickering means it was not working properly. The light of the torch was not glowing properly. Now, as he was moving fitfully down the narrow forest path, fitfully means for a short period, he walks through the forest and his torch light was flickering, which means the light was not steady. Maybe the battery was down, so it was not working properly. So in that flickering light, what did he see? When its flickering light fell in the figure of a boy who was sitting alone on a rock, Mr. Oliver stopped. Now, while he was coming up the hill to go to his school, suddenly he meets a boy who was sitting on a rock. Okay, he meets a boy who was sitting on a rock. He was sitting all alone over there in the middle of the forest. Now, Mr. Oliver obviously stopped because he wanted to see what was happening. Why was this boy here? Boys were not supposed to be out after dark. So, a boy in the middle of the forest meant that the boy must be of that school because it is a hostel. The students used to stay in the school. So, it might happen that some naughty boy, mischievous boy might just have come down the school and was inside the forest. So, boys were not allowed to come here. So, Mr. Oliver wanted to check what is the matter. What are you doing out here, boy? Asked Mr. Oliver. So, Mr. Oliver asked the boy that what he was doing there, sharply moving closer so that he could recognize the miscreant. So, miscreant means somebody who is very naughty, always does mischievous things. So, Mr. Oliver asked the question and moved close to the boy so that he can understand who is that naughty boy who was sitting out here. Obviously, Mr. Oliver was a teacher over there for a long time, so he would recognize the boy. But even as he approached the boy, Mr. Oliver sensed that something was wrong. So as Mr. Oliver was going close to the boy, he felt that something must not be right. There must be something wrong somewhere. Okay, you have no that unnatural feeling, the sixth sense working, that something must be wrong somewhere. The boy appeared to be crying. It seemed that the boy was crying. His head hung down, he held his face in his hands, and his body shook convulsively. What do you mean by convulsively? Convulsively means his body, the boy's body was shaking a lot. He was sobbing. He was hiding his face in his hands and he was continuously weeping. It was a strange, soundless weeping. So when you sob, you just sob. You're just crying, but no sound can be heard. Okay, that kind of a weeping, soundless weeping. And Mr. Oliver felt distinctly uneasy. So Mr. Oliver felt that it was something was very strange, something was wrong here. Okay. So now, well, what's the matter? He asked, his anger giving way to concern. Now the boy was weeping, his face was hidden in his hands. Nobody could see his face. Mr. Oliver could not see his face. Mr. Oliver understood that something must be terribly wrong. What are you crying for? The boy would not answer or look up. So the boy did not answer, nor did the boy look up. Okay, his body continued to be racked with silent sobbing. So his body continued to move, continued to shake as he was going on crying. Come on, boy, you shouldn't be out here at this hour. Now the teacher was, you know, he was feeling worried that what is the problem? Maybe the boy has lost his way. Maybe the boy was a mischievous one. He has come into the forest, but he has lost his way. And that is why he was crying. Tell me the trouble. Look up. Now, the teacher goes on asking him to look up. Speak up. What is the matter? Look up. The boy looked up. Now, finally, the boy looks up. And he took his hands from his face. His face was hidden, isn't it? When you put both of your hands on your face, then what happens? Your face is hidden. So the boy was sobbing like that. Now he looks up and removes his hands from his face and looked up at the teacher. The light from Mr. Oliver's torch fell on the boy's face, if you could call it a face. Now Mr. Oliver was carrying the torch. Now the torch fell on his face. Now what did the teacher see? The teacher saw it had no eyes, ears, nose or mouth, which means that there were no features on the face of the boy. Okay, it was just a face without any nose, eye or a mouth. It was just a round smooth head with a school cap on top of it. That boy was from the school because there is a school cap that he was wearing. But other than that, there was no other feature on his face. And that's where the story should end. Now, this is already quite frightening, isn't it? This could be an end of the story. But for Mr. Oliver, it did not end here. But for Mr. Oliver, this had a little extension to it. This was not the end. What else happened with him? Now, the torch fell from his trembling hand. Now, he was extremely, extremely afraid. You can understand how would you feel when you are in the middle of a forest in the dark and suddenly you meet a small boy who was weeping and you call and ask him what is the matter and you see a flat face without any features. You will be terribly afraid, isn't it? So, the torch fell from his hands. The torch which he was carrying, which Mr. Oliver was carrying, fell from his hand. He turned and scrambled down the path. Now, as he was extremely, extremely afraid, he scrambled down the path. That means he ran in extreme fear. running blindly through the trees and calling for help. He was so afraid that he screamed for help, okay, and ran. He was still running towards the school building when he saw a lantern swinging in the middle of the path. Now, when he was running at full speed to the school, suddenly he met a person in the middle. Okay, what he was carrying? He was carrying a lantern. A man came who was carrying a lantern. He was still, okay, Mr. Oliver stumbled up to the watchman. Now, who was that person who was coming with that lantern? It was the watchman. Gasping, now Mr. Oliver stumbled up to the watchman. Stumbled means he suddenly bumped into or hit the watchman. He was running, no? He was running this way. And from the opposite side, the watchman had come. So he just hit him. Then he was gasping for breath. He was so, you know, when you run, you fall short of breath and you breathe through the mouth. So he was also breathing like that, madly in extreme fear. What is it, Sahib? Asked the watchman. Now the watchman asks him, what is the matter? Why are you running, sir? Has there been an accident? Why are you running? I saw something horrible, a boy weeping in the forest and he had no face. Now who says this? Mr. Oliver says this to the watchman. He says, you know, there is a boy in the middle of the forest and he doesn't have any feature on his face. It is just a flat face. Now the watchman says to Mr. Oliver, no face, Sahib, no eyes, nose, mouth, nothing. Mr. Oliver answers, no, he doesn't even have the nose, eyes, mouth, nothing. He has nothing on his face. Do you mean it was like this, Sahib? Asked the watchman and raised the lamp to his own face. The watchman had no eyes, no ears, no features at all, not even an eyebrow. And that's when the wind blew the lamp out. Now what happened? This watchman was carrying a lamp, okay? Now he raises this lamp to his face. And what does Mr. Oliver see in that light? Mr. Oliver saw, now imagine Mr. Oliver did not carry the torch anymore. It had fallen off from his hands. The watchman was carrying the lamp. And when the watchman raises the lamp to his face, what did Mr. Oliver see? That even this watchman did not have any feature on his face. He also did not have any nose, ear, or eyebrow, or eyes, nothing. Nothing was there on the face of the watchman. So it was quite like the boy that he met in the forest. Now imagine how much a person can be afraid when he already had an experience like that with the small boy. Here is another watchman who looks same like the boy. Okay. Now this is a very nice story, but you can understand that this story has an abrupt ending. You can interpret the story in whichever way you want, but it has to be logical. You have to give reasons why you think that after this, you can be asked that what do you think that will happen after this? It might be a dream. Mr. Oliver might have woken up after this, isn't it? It was just a dream. It might be any other thing that you think, but you have to logically explain that why you think that. Let us see. Let us read this note. This will help you, I think, in writing answers to your questions. The supernatural element. You can understand the story is full of supernatural elements. Two times Mr. Oliver encounters the ghosts. Ruskin Bond once remarked that while he does not believe in ghosts, he sees them all the time. In the woods, in a bar, in a crowd, outside a cinema. So Ruskin Bond, the writer of the story, had once said that he did not believe in ghosts, but he felt that there were ghosts all around him. When you are walking down the corridor in the school, when you are going through an empty road, when you are going to the bar, when a huge number of people are there, when you go to the cinema hall, everywhere, so many people are there. One or two can be ghosts also, isn't it? So it seems that he also believes in ghosts. It is not surprising, therefore, that Bond stories will contain the supernatural elements. Now you can understand, obviously, when a person is saying this, he must be writing stories which has ghosts in it. If you read the stories of Ruskin Bond, you will see that many ghost stories he has written in his life. You can read those also. You can understand they are extremely, extremely exciting. He skillfully uses them to sow the seeds of fear and suspense. Why did I highlight this? This is important. Why does he write stories like this? Because when you have suspense, okay, when the boy was weeping with his hands on his face and you could not see his face, and suddenly then he removes his hands and you see a face without features, this kind of suspense, building up this suspense, and then you are afraid, this rouses the fear more and more, isn't it? You are more afraid when you suddenly see something, okay? That is why he uses suspense over here in the mind of readers. Next, what do you have? Bond attempts to find an outlet for one's loneliness. This is important. See, whenever a person is lonely, he seems to imagine a number of things. Okay, when you get inside a dark room, when you are going to get inside a dark room, you start imagining that when you get inside the room, you might find a ghost or something in the room, isn't it? So when you are lonely, you seem to be afraid. Even in your own house, if you are lonely, you will start getting afraid. But if in the same house your parents are there, your brother and sisters are there, then you won't be afraid, isn't it? So loneliness is a reason to be afraid. It is loneliness and fear that leads a man to imagine the presence of ghosts and other supernatural elements. When you are alone, then you tend to imagine all these things. And the last one, which is important over here, is the story ends with a sense of ambiguity. What is ambiguity? Ambiguity means when it is open to interpretation. I told you already that you can interpret the story in many ways. It has a sudden end and it is an open-ended story. You can interpret the end of the story, that what would happen afterwards, after this thing happens to Mr. Oliver, what can happen? That you can interpret on your own. Making the readers ponder, that means the readers are allowed to think that, okay, whoever is reading the story, you can give it an end. Okay, you can imagine how the story is going to end. Over the question whether they were ghosts that Oliver encountered or whether it was a prank played upon him by mischievous students. See, I told you it could be a dream. One interpretation you can give to the story, that after this, Oliver wakes up from his sleep, number one. Number two, what you can say, that it is obviously a ghost story. There must be two ghosts that he encountered while coming back from the bazaar. Two, and number three, you can also say that it was a prank. Okay, it was a practical joke played on the teacher by the mischievous or by the naughty students. Okay, that there were a few naughty students. There are always naughty students in the school, and some of them must have played a prank or must have played a practical joke on Mr. Oliver. Okay, you can also say this way. You can interpret it in any other way which you want. You can write that to me in the comment section, that what do you think would be the end of the story. I hope you have liked the story a lot. I hope this has helped the ICC students so that you can write your answers, your own answers, frame your own answers. And if you have liked it, please comment and subscribe and share it with your friends so that they can also be benefited from it. Bye-bye.